He is able to do this for us now.
That's right.
Yeah.
Talk, preacher.
After perusing this particular text, I quickly discovered that there is an occurrence of a drought in this text.
My God.
I think I should tell you that this drought is essentially God's punishment upon a people, his people. Some of you may wonder, why would God shut up the heavens and not allow that essential element called rain to fall upon his own people?
My Lord.
Speak, Doc.
Those of you who have studied the history of the Hebrews, you know why God did this. It's because of their disobedience.
Come on.
But in this particular case, ladies and gentlemen, it's more than just their disobedience that caused God to shut up the heavens for 3.5 years. In this case, it is their total rejection of God. You've got to understand that God had been good to Israel. God had blessed them. God had protected them and provided for them, only to discover that Israel had filed for illegal separation on the basis that there was a seemingly more enticing God.
All right.
Who was worthy of that courtship. This God's name was Baal. You got to understand that Israel had been led into the deepest form of idolatry after the ascension to the throne of a weak king who had a wicked wife.
Yeah.
Please understand, that's a deadly combination. For whenever you take a weak man and hook him up with a wicked woman,
watch
you
it.
Got hell on your hands. Ahab, the king of Israel, married Jezebel, the daughter of Ethbaal, who is the king of the Sidonians. She led him, thus leading them into the deepest form of idolatry. Ladies and gentlemen, look at God's people. They are now worshiping an idol God. They are worshiping a dead God. Look at God's people worshiping a God who has eyes, but he's sightless.
Worshiping
a God who has ears, but he cannot hear. They're worshiping a God who has a mouth that's been muted. They're worshiping a God who has legs, but no mobility. Look
Come
at
on.
God's people, ladies and gentlemen. They have rejected the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And they're now jumping and jiggling and gesturing and gyrating around a dead God. But I think I ought to tell you tonight that the God we serve is a jealous God.
Yes, he is.
Jealous God.
I ought to say he's a jealous God.
He's a jealous God.
And because he is a jealous God, God is not going to allow this kind of activity to occur without penalty and punishment. God is not going to allow his children to act any kind of way. It is because he is a jealous God.
Now, preacher,
when I speak in reference to the jealousy of God, I'm not talking about jealousy as we know it to be today.
Yeah.
I'm not talking about this sick, twisted jealousy.
Right.
I'm not talking about this narcissistic jealousy.
Narcissistic.
That's got you stalking somebody.
Right.
Or got you looking in their cell about that kind of jealousy.
Come on.
If you got to do all of that, you don't need them anyhow.
Yeah. Woo! Watch it, Reverend.
But when I speak in reference to the fact that our God is a jealous God, you've got to understand that the word jealousy in the Hebrew literally means to protect.
Yeah.
And so when you see in the scripture that God is a jealous God, essentially what it says is that God loves me so much until he'll do whatever he has to do in order to protect our relationship. God is not going to let me act any kind of way. Whenever I'm in relationship with Almighty God, he's not going to let me keep doing what I want to do, how I want to do it, when I want to do it. It's because he's protecting our relationship. I hear God saying, wait a minute, Bill ain't going to treat you like I'm going to treat you. Bill ain't going to wake you up in the morning. Bill is not going to put food on your table. Bill is not going to put clothes on your back. Bill is not going to rock you when you're lonely. And because you're in relationship with me, I'm going to do whatever I got to do in order to protect what we got going on.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but I believe somebody here in Orange County and in Orange, Texas, feel like I feel when I say I'm glad he's a jealous God, because there is some stuff I would be doing that I still want to do, but God won't let me do everything that I want to do. He will not let me go everywhere that I want to go, because he's a jealous God. And you ought to lift your sanctified hand and say, I'm glad he's a jealous God. Some of us wouldn't be in church tonight if God had let us do some stuff that we really wanted to do. But that says that he is a jealous God. God is a jealous God. He's a jealous God. And he's not going to allow us to do any kind of way without penalty and punishment. So he summons the prophet Elijah.
Yeah.
And he tells him, I want you to go unto Ahab and declare unto him, because of the wicked ways of my people, I'm getting ready to shut up the heavens and not allow that essential element called rain or precipitation to fall to the ground.
Yeah.
But can I tell you what I love about God? What I love about God is that when penalty and punishment occurs, the God I serve will still take care of his own.
Yeah.
That was a good place to shout right there. To know that even when famine and when drought and when shortage and when scarcity occurs, God will still take care of the righteous.
Yeah.
I need a witness here. David said, about God, I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. God will take care of his own, and somebody ought to be giving him praise for that, because we're just on the tail end of a recession and a depression. And you lost your job, but you kept your house because God took care of you. You lost your money, but you still had food on the table every day.
Come on.
God took care of you.
Yeah.
You lost some stuff, but you're still as healthy as you need to be, because God took care of you. Somebody ought to get in praise, because even in the midst of shortage and scarcity, the God I serve will still take care of his own. If he's got to pull fish out of fish and bread out of bread, he can still do it. In the midst of a drought, I'm feeling like preaching now.
Preach this thing.
Tell somebody, let's have church tonight.
Let's have church tonight. Woo!
Of a drought,
you're preaching, man.
He instructs the prophet Elijah. I want you to take up residence at a place called the Brook Cherith. He says that it is there that I'm going to summon some birds. I'm going to make one a butcher. And the other a baker. They're going to bring you bread and meat in the morning. Meat and bread in the evening. Look at this righteous man. Look at this man of God chilling down at the brook while the birds are bringing him meat and bread morning and evening. According to theologians, the prophet Elijah stayed there for about a year and a half. When we get to verse number 7, now he's been there for a year and a half, birds bringing him his breakfast and dinner, and he's getting water from the brook. When we get to verse 7 of our text, it says, and it came to pass. Now you gotta watch that phrase right there. Because that tells you something getting ready to change.
Come on.
Look at somebody and tell them it's getting ready to change.
It's getting ready to change.
The text says that it came to pass that the brook dried and the birds expired. But I ought to tell you tonight, ladies and gentlemen, that a dry brook is not necessarily a negative thing. Because what we're going to see in the text, we're going to see some things that happen after the drying of the brook. Y'all got time to be okay, right?
Preach it, preach it. Come on.
Now, let's look at some stuff that happened after the drying of the brook. First thing I want you to see is that Elijah heard the word of God. Come on, say it after me. He heard the word of God.
He heard the word of God.
Watch the text, verse 8 says, and the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, now I know I have some theologians in here, and I know I have some homileticians and expositors in here who will say, wait a minute, Reverend, this is not the first time that he heard the word of God, because the same phrase is located in verse 2 of our text. And Elijah heard the word of God, or the word of the Lord came unto him saying. But it is here again in verse number 8 that the word of the Lord came unto him saying. And the reason why I'm pointing this out is because I understand the nature of Negro. In that it takes some dry brooks for some of us before we will simply hear the word of the Lord. All right, you can get with that. Some of you, as long as your job is going well and your money is right and your health is right, you don't want to hear much of what God has to say. Lay off on your dime. In fact, there are some folk who should have been here tonight and would have been here to hear the word of the Lord. I know their problem. I know their problem. Their brook had dried yet. But you watch the same folk when they're going through some stuff. I wonder if I have a witness here. When the brook dried, when the bear you can't beat them coming to church. But maybe, wait a minute, some of us who are here, we are here, but we ain't interested in hearing the word of the Lord.
Come on.
I know your problem.
Come on. Tell it.
Everything is still wet.